the tree of good and evil, Satan asked through the serpent, did God really say you must not eat the fruit in this garden?
Amen.
Happy Sabbath.
I would be proud to be a father. Those kids. And we are just so blessed that we have so many talents in this church. And we try to include everyone, children most especially. It would be a special treat if you can include all your family. Our speaker this morning is raised in Knoxville, Tennessee. Both parents still reside there. He has one brother, one sister, and they both live in California. Our speaker married his high school sweetheart. He wrote girlfriend, but I said sweetheart. And they were blessed, and will be Miss Joanne, the one that gave us the children's story. And they're blessed with three good-looking sons.
Talented.
And they're part of our ensemble. They also gave our special music, Coles, the one that read the scripture reading. They're Vance, Preston, and Cole. They lived in California for 4 years, and they were in Asheville, North Carolina for 10 years, and in Ormond Beach, Florida for 8 years, and now here in Virginia Beach, Virginia. And living in Chesapeake. He worked in manufacturing and food processing industries prior to healthcare. And now, church, I give you our speaker of the hour, Michael Gentry.
Toast in the new year. That's exactly what I did.
I turned to the television set, watched the little ball drop, drank the stuff, and said, I need to go to bed, I'm tired. But I started the year on the right foot, doing what I was told to do. But on day six of the new year, I had already had my first fall. Day six of the new year was yesterday. And as I sat down, and this was a full week, probably for many of us, this was a very full week. You know, it seems like things are held during the holidays. The holidays are a little hectic, a lot of personal time, and then there's a work catch-up, sort of that first week, and probably goes into the next week. So this week wasn't good. I mean, it wasn't bad. It wasn't terribly good. It was just full. And got home, went upstairs, and came back down to have supper. And on the supper table, there was a bowl with berries and cherries and candles in it. Berries and cherries and candle. Vance looked at me and he said, you're in trouble. Of course, I realized that should have been a cake because it was my wife's birthday. Appreciated his insight into the fact that I was about to be, you know, in trouble. So beginnings have different perspectives. If you would, get your Bible and turn to Matthew chapter 28. Matthew chapter 28. I'm going to start reading there, verse 1, Matthew chapter 28. Now after the Sabbath, as the first day of the week began to dawn, Mary Magdalene and the other Mary came to see the tomb. And behold, there was a great earthquake, for an angel of the Lord descended from heaven and came and rolled back the stone from the door and sat on it. His countenance was like lightning, and his clothing as white as snow. And the guards shook for fear of him and became like dead men. But the angel answered and said to the women, do not be afraid, for I know that you seek Jesus who was crucified. He is not here, for he is risen. That's the beginning of something. That chapter, chapter 28, this first seven verses, lay out the beginning of something. What do they lay out the beginning of? Can somebody tell me?
The resurrection and the spreading of the gospel.
The beginning of the spreading of the gospel. I'm thinking about the beginning of something that an individual would take very personally, and use the term individual loosely. Christ has just risen.
Mm-hmm.
Who on planet Earth, or who in the universe, would mark that as the beginning of what? If you're the devil, it's the beginning
of the end.
You know how you've perhaps seen on television, sometimes people have these clocks, and they'll say the average lifespan is 82 years, and what you should do is buy one of these clocks and peg it at 82, and then whatever your age is, you turn it backwards, and every day this thing. Have you seen those? Well, I can get you one. But that's what happened on resurrection morning. The countdown began. Things became very, very real for the devil. It's one thing philosophically to understand something. It's something else to have witnessed God take you on personally and win. Yes. The devil threw everything he had at Christ when Christ came here. Everything he had, he threw at Christ. And Christ won. Amen. It was the beginning of the end. It was also the beginning of God fulfilling the promise that he made to Adam. The promise to Adam was what? What was the promise to Adam? That what happened could be rectified, right? Adam probably thought that was going to happen in his lifetime, but that the sin that had happened would be rectified. Let's go back to the verse that Cole read to us. Let's swing back to Genesis chapter 3.
Genesis chapter 3. This is what Paul read. Now the serpent was more cunning than any beast in the field which the Lord God had made. And he said to the woman, has God indeed said, you shall not eat of every tree of the garden? 2 points. This is a recognition that the Bible is telling us that the devil is extraordinarily intelligent. The serpent was more cunning than any beast of the field which the Lord God had made. So we need to recognize the caliber, the intellectual horsepower that the devil possesses. It's significant. And then he poses a question. Has God indeed said it? Have you ever worked around people that ask questions they know the answer to? What's that called?
Rhetorical.
It's a setup, right? It can be a rhetorical, but if you're a little cynical, it's a setup, right? They know the answer they're looking for. They're just seeing if you're smart enough to give it to them, right? They're just seeing if you know something, but they already know what they want to know. Flip back a page in your Bible, probably, and look at Genesis 1. 26 and 27. Let's read that. Genesis chapter 1, 26 and 27. So now we're on the sixth day of creation. Then God said, let us make man in our image, according to our likeness. Let them have dominion over the fish of the sea, the birds of the air, over the cattle, over all the earth, and every creeping thing that creeps on the earth. So let us make man, let's give man dominion. And then 27. So God created man in his own image. In the image of God, he created him. Male and female, he created him. We are unbelievably messed up, and we're unbelievably blessed. I'm going to read something. This is a book called Education. And many Adventists would say that a lot of the thoughts in this book are inspired. So I'm going to read something from the book Education. When Adam came from the Creator's hand, he bore in his physical, mental, and spiritual nature a likeness to his Maker. Well, that matches up with what the Bible just said, the image of God, a likeness to his Maker. God created man in his own image, Genesis 1:27, and it was his purpose that the longer man lived and the more fully he should reveal this image and reflect the glory of the Creator. One of my dad's quotes, and he had plenty of quotes, but one of the quotes was, by beholding, you become changed. What's influencing you? What are you around? What's affecting you? What are you watching? What are you listening to? Because the environment around us changes us. In management, we would say that we can make changes. There's a topic that gets a lot of energy these days called change management, where you're trying to modify behavior. And you do that by tools and techniques, but you have different skills and practice. There's an argument that goes back and forth in the media sometimes about kids and if they play violent video games, does that play out to their behavior? Does their behavior become violent if they do a violent video game? And so there's an argument, people argue both sides of that. What most people will say and come to agreement on is that behavior can be modified and changed. And so it can probably get a little worse, probably get a little better. The Bible stated that we were created in God's image. So here's the thought. That was a long time ago. Just as you can look on something it was beautifully made, and maybe it's several hundred years old, and you can see the decline of time, perhaps of a ship. Maybe you still have beautiful lines, or perhaps it's a building, an architect did a beautiful job. You can see the wear of nature on it. It still holds some of the original beauty. And I wonder if that's true about us, is that we were made in the likeness of God, but we've been through 6,000 years of sin affecting us. And so, flip back with me now to chapter 3 again. Genesis 1 talks about the beginning of God's creative work. That's the Genesis story. What did God do in the beginning? How did he create this world? How were we created? Genesis chapter 3 talks about the beginning of when sin, of when the devil started interacting with mankind. Let's look at that closely. Because in Genesis 1, we have we're in the image of God, and in Genesis 3, we have what started to modify us from that original image. If you think about a building, what started to stain it, what started to happen, what leaks were caused, why did the roof age the way it did? So let's look at this one more time. Now the serpent was more cunning than any beast of the field. And he said to the woman, "Has God indeed said, 'You shall not eat of every tree of the garden?'" And the woman said to the serpent, "We may eat of the fruit of the trees of the garden, but the fruit of the tree which is in the midst of the garden, God has said, 'You shall not eat it or touch it, lest you surely die.'" Then the serpent said to the woman, "You will not surely die. For God knows that in the day you eat of it, your eyes will be opened, and you will be like God, knowing good from evil." So when the woman saw the tree was good for food, that it was pleasant to the eyes, and a tree desirable to make one wise, she took the fruit and ate. She also gave it to her husband. Think about this first seven verses in chapter 3. The proximity of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil in the Garden of Eden was where? Where was it?
The middle.
In the middle.
It's in the middle. So does that make it obvious or obscure? Hard to miss, right? Hard to miss. It wasn't tucked away on the edge of the garden, blocked by a 6-foot-high barbed wire fence. Middle of the garden, easy access. When we look at trying to understand God, recognizing we have this filter when we try and understand God. We have this filter of sin that we're looking through, trying to see what God is like. We read earlier about when the angel came down from heaven, came down like lightning and was white like snow. And so that's not how we appear to each other. We don't really think, "Hey, there's my lightning guy." You know, that's not how we see each other, because that's not how we are. We have calluses and many challenges about our appearances and also behavior. And looking at this, point number one is we are dealing with a very intelligent entity. We should respect that. This mindset that sometimes slides into us that God is helpful, but there's a lot I can handle. We are kidding ourselves. We are absolutely kidding ourselves when we have this mindset. God can help me here, I can handle here. And I know, because I know to avoid this stuff over here. I think that's a thought that the devil would enjoy us to hang on to. Second, when we're talking about temptation, God apparently is not afraid of allowing us to be tempted. He does not take temptations and put them over in the corner of the Garden of Eden. He was willing to set the temptation front and center. And so almost as if you want to go down that road, that's available. It's not hidden, it's not disguised, it's available. But I'm here as well. And so the choice is easy and clear. It's something you have to go and really search around and try and find. If you want another choice aside from God's will in your life, that's available. So Adam's created, he's perfect, Eve's there, she's perfect, and they have this tree in the middle of the garden. We're here today. We're not in the garden. We're a pretty nice place, but we're not in the garden. Is there one tree today? Think about the effect of sin. God gave a choice. Do God's will. Don't eat the tree of the fruit of knowledge of good and evil. Don't do that. Everything else you can have. There's a thousand other trees here. I don't know the number, but there were a number of other trees. Don't eat the fruit from this tree. 6,000 years later, through sin, how many trees are there? There's a lot more than one. Aren't there?
Mm-hmm.
planter. He's got quite a number of trees. You get, 300 feet, away in your car. We have all sorts of options if we want to sin today. We just don't have to go find one tree and eat some fruit. We have many, many, many options to sin, right?
That's right.
God apparently is not afraid of the power of choice. He seems to be very comfortable, and not only just comfortable, he seems to be very supportive of us having total freedom of choice. So the dialogue with Eve and the serpent continues. First, the serpent asks a question, places some doubt, knows the answer to the question, but asks it anyway. When Eve engages, and this is where I'm talking about where we think we're okay, and God helps us over here, but we're okay in this area. When we engage and have dialogue without God, then the serpent said to the woman, "You will not surely die." So it goes from planting a seed of doubt to engaging in some dialogue to taking on God. What was the appeal? Eve's there, what's the appeal? Probably not a lot different than the appeal today. It was pleasant to the eyes, our senses. You think about the five senses we have: touch, smell, taste, hearing, and visual. Those are the avenues that we can be a blessing to others, and those are the avenues that things can come in and not be so helpful. Kind of like the internet. The internet is a powerful tool for business. It's a powerful tool for many positive uses, and there's also some traffic coming the other way that's not so great. In Genesis chapter 1, the Bible starts off with God's creative power. In Genesis chapter 3, we get an idea of the devil's destructive power. There are two forces that are going on right now, and it's the beginning of the year. The devil's facing a countdown clock. If you woke up every morning and you faced a countdown clock, would your anxiety meter go up or down? It would go up, wouldn't it? If you're facing a countdown clock, would you become, if you were trying to get something done, and all of us have had deadlines we didn't like, we wanted to accomplish something at work, you start pedaling faster and faster, your judgment gets better or worse?
Worse.
Panic attack. You start trying to do about anything. So, a couple of thoughts on this. First, let's look at Luke 10, verse 17. Luke 10, verse 17. I'm going to read 17 through 20. Then the 70 returned with joy, saying, "Lord, even when the demons are subject to us, even the demons are subject to us in your name." And he said to them, "I saw Satan fall like lightning from heaven." That's interesting. "Behold, I give you authority to trample on serpents and scorpions and over all the power of the enemy, and nothing by any means shall ever hurt you. Nevertheless, do not rejoice in this, that the spirits are subject to you, but rather rejoice because your names are written in heaven." I think we need to ask ourselves on a pretty regular basis, do we think like God? We were made in the image of God. Originally, we had thoughts like God. God designed us to be developed to grow closer and closer to Him over time. Enoch invested his time in getting to know God and walk with God. And so if we spend time and we're drawing closer and closer to God, then perhaps we're doing what God would desire us to do. In this verse, it's talking about the focus of the mind. God had given these 70 disciples unusual powers to be an enormous benefit and blessing to others. Unusual powers. They couldn't be touched. But he said, don't rejoice in that. Rejoice in the fact that your names are written in heaven. In other words, that we will be together. It's interesting that I've given you these powers. And that's wonderful and something to be thankful for, but that's not where your mind should be. Your mind should be the fact that we are going to be together. And so that's a little bit of what's God looking forward to. He's looking forward to time with us. Let's go to Exodus 20. We'll start reading here the first couple of commandments of Exodus 20. God spoke all these words, saying, I am the Lord your God who brought you out of the land of Egypt and out of the house of bondage. You shall have no other gods before me. You shall not make yourself a carved image. You shall not bow down or serve me, for I am the Lord your God, a jealous God, visiting the iniquity of the fathers upon the children of the third and fourth generation. You shall not take the name of the Lord your God in vain, for the Lord will not hold him guiltless who takes his name in vain. If you think about God today from a standpoint of just being a typical American, and if you've watched any of the political debates either this year or the past few years, I haven't watched a lot this year, but I watched a couple, I guess, 4 years ago, or two or three years ago. And I remember one of them, they went around the candidates and they said, which of you believe in creation? And I think only one person said they believe in creation. It is painted, and we are led to believe that it is intellectually idiotic to believe in creation. And so we're looking for somebody to raise their hand and say that so you can write them off as a lunatic. Now, it's still okay to have some casual relationship with God or to admit, well, I believe in God. But our society has moved to, I believe in God, for the areas that are comfortable for me to believe in and don't make me feel awkward in any way, shape, or form. If you're the devil, and if you've got a countdown clock, you started with Eve and you've got a countdown clock after the resurrection, you would have a strategy about how to minimize God and how to minimize the interest that individuals have in God. And his initial strategy was to lay some doubt and sort of to be, sneaky is maybe not a good enough word, but cunning is a pretty good word. And so you wouldn't just take on God, because you have a lot of people that are Christians that would back away from anyone that would take on God. But you might work around the edges. So I would ask you a couple of questions. For a typical science curriculum in college, if you don't believe in evolution, then you're really, really questioned. That would be working around the edge. In politics, if you stood up and said, I absolutely believe in the whole Bible, you would be immediately labeled as a fundamentalist idiot. Idiot may be strong, but some sort of somebody that's completely out of touch. Culturally, one of the most common phrases today is, oh my
God.
Oh my God. That gives potentially a very common meaning to God's name. You don't think of King of Kings, Lord of Lords, the God of the universe. It makes it more common. And you could say it challenges.